myself, my name is Lisa Salamado. I am a board member of the San Francisco Latino Nomads Pride Club. I'm founder of Fear Not Next Happy Hour, and I also have to be a board member of the NAPD Historical Society. So, seeing that the Historical Society collects, preserves, exhibits, and makes accessible to the public materials and knowledge to support and promote understanding of LGBTQ history, culture, and arts in all our diversity. So in addition to the museum, which you're in, we also have the archives downtown, which contains approximately 800 collections of personal papers, photographs, organizational records, audiovisual recordings, and the archives are actually open to the public. You can go online and see what the hours are. Lastly, we're a membership-driven organization, so we have various membership levels starting at $30 per year. And we also have our Legacy Circle program, where you designate the society as a beneficiary in your estate planning. And all of this info is actually on our website, glbthistory.org, and it's also in the pamphlets that were on your chairs, so we can visit that. So on that note, I'd like to hand it over to the facilitator of our panel, dear friend, longtime friend and activist, Rebecca Hensler.
I end up calling sort of intersectional advocacy through could give yourself a little more credit than that, because always, like I said, there are lots of people here actually who like, there are people here who I know and I don't know, who enable and encourage like all of the things, and when one way or other I've been able to do, either as an artist, either as a hip-hop artist, as a poet, as an HIV worker, and advocate, or just in being in community, taking like participating in community events. So quickly, I've been here since 1990, moved to the Bay Area since 1999, came out in 1995, and with the fun story about the my coming out experience was standing in Tower Records in Chicago on Clark Street and reading and finding anything in Blues magazine for the first time, and standing there with a copy of it shaking, like holding, and they were holding with the three people holding the copy of Newsweek that had the bisexual.
That was you. Okay, so that was you. Okay.
And I'm standing there, and I'm going, you know, my then girlfriend, like, and we moved to the Bay Area, and I'm going to write for this magazine. And so, and I think around that same time, she was a video artist, so I got to see Black Nation's Queer Nation. And I got to, and I found out who, like, I knew Essex Hemphill and the whole Tons on Tag crew, but it was through there that I first encountered Ibrahim Farmajaje. And so I was like, oh my God, the dreadlock freak, black man, oh my God, it's pretty, oh, look at my mind. And it was again through ATM that I first encountered Judge Muscat and Rainbow Flavor Sound System, and I had been doing music since the late 80s, and had stopped when I came out, and then I'm like, okay, I'm going to find these cats, and it was through Judge. If I had not done the work I got to do with Rainbow Flavor, I would not have gotten to do DJ Collective. Came later, and by that extension, participate in Peace Out Festival, and pick up the mic and documentary about the whole scene as it grew, and then the legs that extended for that into performance art and disability activism, and like, oh hey, I've been chronically ill since I was a child. Let's do some stuff for Sending Valley and Mangos with Chili. So I've gotten to work in meeting Carol, and it was like, and everybody here who I got in Kawaz, I met later, like, I guess like 2005. So it was like, there's a lot of different threads I think that'll come out, a lot of different space I've gotten to participate in. So I say that about the people you know who are here, but also people who aren't here, who don't know that they were a part of that. So like just the whole, this kind of showing up, because I was like, wow, there's a room full of people here. This is why I've gotten to do the things I've gotten to do. I've had the people at my back while I got the chance to hold the window open for a lot of other people that I like to think of. So thank you all for helping me do me. That's the way I can say that. Really, thank you.
Challenge, still living in Eugene, which was overrun by a particular may have helped with that a little bit, but I think I hit my stride as far as that was concerned when I came to San Francisco. Obviously, like I all, I came to San Francisco to be kind of queer that I was or should have been, unless some of you were actually born here and just grew in the fertile soil of our town. specifically to get my doctorate at the Institute for Advanced Study of Human Sexuality. I had been the LGBTQ college kid in Oregon, ran that organization. I helped found the first LGBT youth group there. I think the third one in the country, but I don't know if there's a real history of that yet. Anybody need to do your dissertation? Not that, that'd be good. And, but like when I was 17, I started working with some young men to make that happen. And so when HIV happened, it made me realize that I actually could be queer when I grew up as a black job. And that I needed more backup and that I needed to go where the work was so needed and there were so many deep levels of it. And so being here allowed me access to the bi community that was already very lively and developed in the Bay Area. There were not very many places that had really open active bi communities in the late 80s. Boston was one, Seattle was one, the Bay Area, of course, was one. And the Bisexual Center, which was closed by the time I got here, had been opened in the very late 70s, the very early 80s, I'm not sure which, but David Gloria, who was one of my professors at the Sex Institute. So I got the sense that I at least had a link to the emerging community here and knew many of the people who were activists then and helped with organizing for the big bi conference that we had in 1990. Yeah. A very fabulous, big bisexual conference with people came from all over the place. I was a bisexual person during the time that it was common for people to say that I needed to choose one or the other, that I was sitting on a fence, et cetera, blah, blah, kind of hate speech, certainly microaggression, just bullshit, basically, right, just bullshit. And I had hoped that there would be no more of that by this time. I'm fully aware that there's still a little of that going around, but with any luck, we will knock that. There's so many things to do that are important. That's only one. A lot of things to do that are important. But as we join together with other people who are not well represented and not well served by the culture that has grown up suddenly or not in the United States, I just feel like we need to stay present, visible, bisexual, or bi plus. As they told me at the last Obama-era shindig that they held for bi people during Bi Visibility Week a couple of years ago, bi plus being now a way to try to reinvent, if that's the right respectful way of putting it, bisexuality for non-gender binary generation. So I never thought that bisexual meant only two. I always would feel like it meant boundary crossing. So that's still really interesting. And I am, I'll just say one more thing. As Rebecca said, I'm the founding director of the Center for Sex and Culture, and we just got our first Horizons grant recently. Thank you, Horizons! For a minute, there were too many heterosexuals that hung out at the summer. Oh, my God, but as Rebecca pointed out, they hang out with us for long enough. Because we're real charming and accessible humans, most of us. So we got this grant for programming around sex workers and bisexual folks. So please tune into the Center for Sex and Culture website sometime in the next month or so, because I'm going to set up some gatherings where we can both be convivial and friendly with one another, but also have interesting conversations and meet interesting bi people and stuff like that. So that'll happen. Cool. Awesome.
it's like we were like I was we were it was just 20 because we were over the top and I'm like, oh my I'm like, oh, it was you!
That's you!
Yeah, yeah, that was me and my lover at the time, and then another one about them. So, yes, I was part of the group that did that. So, when Terry asked me to do this, one of my conditions was I don't want to do this on as much as there are so many people who have done this amazing work over the years, is that I don't want to do this just with a group of us who are of the same generation. And my work, like Sam said, and some of us sort of are still doing a lot of group work, and some of us have moved on and are doing other things. I am very lucky that my work as a middle school counselor intersects with my work as a queer activist and advocate. I'm the LGBT support liaison at my middle school and work with our diversity club. And so I've really gotten to see that coming out as bi is very different now. The experience and very the same in some ways and very different. And I really, rather than talking about that myself, wanted there to be a voice on this panel to talk about what that experience looks like now and what it feels like now. And then I put out the word to all my connections and begged and pleaded and said, no, please, you know, send this to everyone you know. And I feel very, very lucky that that message got out and somehow got to Amara Santos. Amara Pilar Santos is a bisexual indigenous student at San Francisco's Academy High School. Her dream is to own her own cosmetic line and to use that as a platform for social justice by having diverse models, large range of foundations for all skin tones and types, and ensure fair trade contracts for her ingredients. So that's amazing, right? No, it's not just I want my own makeup line. It's like, it's gonna, you know, I'm gonna be an activist in this way and this way and this way, and I care about all these issues, and that is so representative of her, the best of her generation. And I will let her tell you a little about herself.
So I feel like I'm not gonna talk for a while because my voice is gone. And also, I'm only 16, so I don't want to explain it. Like when I was growing up, I grew up in the Excelsior district, and I would necessarily say conservative because I feel, especially like my family, we kind of associate being conservative with like white. We weren't necessarily progressive in a lot of different ways, and I never really questioned it because like what was there to question? That was all I kind of knew. I didn't necessarily know that I was bisexual. But every time I think about it, I think about this one friend I had in elementary school, and I don't think I even had romantic feelings or even just liked her like that or anything. I don't know, I always think about her. I think she should my best friend, I like mentioning her. but I think it's kind of started more questioning in middle school. That was the only label I knew. I didn't know anything outside of that. I didn't know what T really meant or Q and part of LGBTQ. So I was like, oh, I don't think I really want that to be me. I wanted to really dissociate from that because I only heard so many things about the community and they're always kind of negative. So I was like, no, I'm going to go labelless. And it was kind of, I guess, simple to hide from that because at the time I had a boyfriend, I had all straight friends and people that were bi, were the girls, and then there was like, oh, questioning, oh, that's a bit promiscuous, so I was like, not me. But I didn't really have any support. I didn't know anything about it. Until I met somebody in, I want to say, seventh grade, and they kind of taught me about the community as well, and they said they identified as transsexual, and I was like, I don't know, it's like, for a while, it was really difficult because it was just it was almost on putting on different personas every day, so this could mean that this wasn't, and it was really difficult for me. I think that so I really, really took to that. A lot of kids were like, oh, that's cool to know. But like after a while, they were like, well, that's kind of like too extreme. You don't need to read into activism that much. Everything's going to be offensive. But I just, I don't know, I really, really took to that. Ever since then, like, I just, that's just all I really think about. And like a lot of people at my school like know that, whether that be like positively or negatively. I think my identity of being bisexual like does play into kind of everything that I do. I always find that I'm like constantly coming out to people because when I talk about things, I mention straight people, they're like, I mean, I'm like, your community. I'm like, what do you mean? I'm not like straight. And they're like, what about your boyfriend? I'm like, he's, I don't know, alpha. What is that? Like, not alpha. And so it's kind of unfortunate because I always find that people are like, are you gay? I'm like, no. Like, are you bi? I'm like, yeah. But it's like, I am, and I'm proud of that. But it's only because those are the only options they knew. It's either like, it's very on like, not even a spectrum, it's like these three options. And I'm not, it's not unfortunate, it's just unfortunate that they're like lack of understanding of the fluidity of sexuality. It's been like, I guess, for lack of a word, like a difficult process to understand everything, just trying to unlearn everything from my childhood and learn from other communities and so forth. But it's, you know, it's been like a really good journey, and I only find myself like growing more, like kind of every day, just as I get older and stuff. And it's really nice to hear that, like, and see people here who are older and still identify as bisexual, because I had a bunch of, like, internalized things I had to work out, like, this is just a phase, and, you know, all these bad things, and it, like, took me a while to come out to my boyfriend, came out to him, like, a year and a half from our relationship, and I was really worried that he was, like, going to leave me, because he never really said one way or another how he felt about, LGBT community, and I find that like once I came out, I kind of like not necessarily hit rock bottom, but it was like really unfortunate about the things that I faced and like felt. But I found like people at my school, because we do have a really big queer and trans population at our school, but it was just really nice to have that. And I just find like when I think back, like I'm in such a progressive city, especially in like a queer aspect, and then also in my school, so it's like no matter how hard it felt, it always felt like some like. Like the university, like a higher power was always like going to work out these or this sort of things that you have to work through. But it was really fortunate. Mm-hmm.
So, Kawaza, as far as the other person on the panel who I did not know until tonight, but I'm very delighted to meet. I was really impressed, even though your bio was not long, it was thick. It was like really a rich biography that was like telling, I think, a lot of history. That you were a member of Bipol, which was, as far as I know, at one of the earliest major bipolitical organizations. He was on the board of their bisexual network, right? This is great. He's been chair of the bisexual committee of the National Organization of Men Against Sexism, and also a member of Pride at Work, which is SEIU project, right?
SEIU.
So that's like I said, like he has this long history of activism in a lot of different areas. So what's new about yourself?
What about myself? So I was born in the city here, grew up in San Francisco. My early experience with activism was actually around racial discrimination. At the time I was growing up, contrary to the popularity of San Francisco, it was racialized. My early inspiration was from the San Francisco State students, not the strike. Prior to the strike, there were a number of students at San Francisco State who did a demonstration in downtown San Francisco, one of the hotels. The demonstration was around the fact that even though there were African dignitaries staying there, they would not hire African grandchildren grew up with. I was informed by the Compton Riot. Everybody knows Stonewall. Before Stonewall, there was people cut with transgender, cross-dressers, transvestites, who rioted here in San Francisco. So this kind of informed my thinking. Ralph and I, we were using Alex and in the 80s, I had the fortune to do some volunteer work in Oakland at the Mensing of Health Education. This was a project that actually operated out of Clint Cooper and Rossi. We gave information to men on reproductive health. We then handed their partner information around if you were with the partner and they have an abortion. What does that look like? How are you involved? Information on what does that look like? Having a conversation with your partner. From that, I got involved in FINSTA, which led to being involved with a friend from Camp Coffee, which were the guys who were protesting the beauty pageants and the stereotyping of women and the expansion. From that, I got involved with some men who did some couple of conferences in Oakland. Men of Color Conference on specifically men of color, gay, bi, straight, and our issues as men. Late 80s, I hear of this group that you're invited to. Social events that were happening in homes in the East Bay primarily. However, what the important piece was is that at one of these events, this woman comes up and says, "I heard about you." And she introduced herself. This line came up. We had a conversation. In that conversation, I met, oh, there's a group of folks who are bisexual who are doing things on a more active level. There was a discussion to have a conference here in San Francisco in 1990. Looking back on it, that was a phenomenal piece of work. One, the various communities with all those folks from various areas. We had people who were in psychotherapy, we had activists, we had youth, some people who were involved. It was quite an accomplishment. However, there's one thing I think that in spite of the success, wow, how do we miss that? The one piece that we missed, we had people, over 400 people from all the world, England, Australia, across the country. What we missed was we did not promote it here. The promotion was by communities and here in the Bay Area, it was a little bad. It was held Pride Weekend, so there was maybe like such information on the papers. That wouldn't happen today. Out of that conference, we had a people of color bisexual group that emerged. And I say that because it's important that even as we talk about the sexual differences in terms of gay, lesbian, bisexual, person of color, there's so many issues that come up that we still have to address. When I was younger and growing up in the city, I hated coming to the classroom. I absolutely hated it. I hated it because in the car, black men going to the bar. And I said, why am I fighting with my audience? And if we're all queer, why am I being treated? So it's not as prominent, still now. But from the conference, there were still people at other conferences and Vinet, a lot of work there. But I also got involved in other little areas in the BLD community. one little event was the Pacifics. The Pacific Center's been around for a long time. They have speakers here. However, they were refusing to let bisexuals be part of the speakers. I couldn't have been otherwise. We had a number of, I would say, needs around including bisexuals as part of a panel that included lesbian, gay, and transgender. That was, it was interesting because of the process. You know, she was just talking about us, but did not force. Some of the other work has been as part of my union with my SMB, working with the Trident work, where we try to include in our contract language information and language that deals with sexual minority issues. So that it's clear. And people say, well, why is that not here? Because if it's not there and the issue comes up, we did have an issue regarding the person who was transitioning on the job was getting shit, you know, from co-workers and the manager. And so without having language to deal with that, it's hard to fight for them being present in the job. I'll say one other thing. I have found it interesting that I've had to press for the presence of bisexuals in various areas. Another group I was involved with that we had an issue around, including bisexuals, was BLM, the American Medical Association. There was not so subtle bifurcated jokes that we had to actually address them. So, one thing that I
think. Thank you. And I feel like that sort of segues in some ways because you kind of answered my next question. And so I wanted to give other people an opportunity to answer this question. What are some of the things, I feel like as an activist, one of the things is, especially when, like, most of my activism is activism, where we're all like, we have to be doing everything all of the time. And you didn't get a lot of chance to sort of stop and go, okay, what are we doing that we think really made a difference? And so I was kind of wondering, looking back, if, you know, if some of you can answer, what are some of the things you did where, when you look back to 70, 30 years, whether you're a bi-dyke or, you know,
into a community, I sort of feel like that part of the process gets a little bit skipped or personalized maybe. Like, people sit around and chat with each other and exchange coming out stories. And there was a time when coming out stories were such a crucial link. So that was part of my history already when I sat down to write what was essentially mine. And it was important for me, in the first place, I just want to say, because I was writing this in the 1980s, that we were not, the entire community wasn't using the word queer as it does now, and in particular, queer wasn't being used as a sometimes euphemism for bisexuality, at least in part, or used by bisexuals who, for one reason or another, don't want to identify as bi. But definitely, at least sometimes, or would if they got the opportunity, felt like it. So the word in that context was hearkening for me to my community in the 70s that I came out in, where queer was used by, especially the radical gay men, and it was a term that meant homosexual to me at the moment that I was writing it, except also a cultural queerness that, you know, queer nature, you know, queer studies, and queer being off the brain, you know. And it was really important for me to link that time of lesbian identity to the fact that I had been bi all along, that I had to take on a sexual orientation that wasn't fully mine, was partly mine, was half mine for sure, but it was not fully mine in order to fit into community. And my piece was a riff on that. And I got a lot of good feedback for this essay that tells me, I think, that I touched some topics that were that people were wrestling with at that moment. And it certainly cemented for me that I had a place and a role and a voice. And having a voice as a bi person, particularly in those days, that was not a given, right? You had to speak up, you had to bitch, you had to bug people, you had to say, and bisexual, all the fucking time. So, yeah. So, and for me, being part of this volume of other people's essays, too, was such an honor. It was really meaningful to sink into my community in a way that was going to be permanent. This book was big, and I was there, and that was that.
A couple of different things come to mind for me. You know, certainly participating in the 1990s was significant, but in terms of what I've done within the Bible historical narrative, that is very significant.
wasn't anybody who said, and so therefore I will start it. And I was like, all right, so temporarily, I commit to getting a post office box that will have our temporary name assigned to it, and I'll hold the key. But there will be two keys, so somebody else should take the second key. And nobody did. Literally nobody did. And I went looking for the people who had wanted to start the whole thing, and they were like, rumor. It was a great idea when it was abstract. And the reality of it was like, no. And so I held the key and started what is now Bynet USA. And it's this sense of like, all right, so let's call people and find out what's happening there so I can get some news of the day, a political newsletter. And it's that feeling of like, you know, who knows what action you're going to take that's going to actually have a lasting impact. I just didn't want that conversation to go into the ether. And so I was like, fine, you know, I have no time, I work for a nonprofit, I have no money, whatever, but I can get us a post office. And so that's how it started. And so I feel really great about that one as a huge thing. And then the second one that I have to say, because I kind of breezed through it in the intro, is when you talk about how important it is to get the language into things. So some of my activists live in the organization that is now the Wellness Center for API, the API Wellness Center. I was brought on with pretty much zero experience, but I told them that in a job interview, that, you know, to do PR, social outreach, and a lot of kind of stuff for this organization called CHICHA, the Gap of Community HIV Project, which is an acronym, marriage, another acronym, inside another acronym, we're good at that. And very soon after starting, the Japanese American citizens, they came to CHICHA and said, there's a small group of people that would like to change the constitution of the Japanese American citizens and add a non-discrimination clause for sexual orientation. I don't think they had gender in there, but we'd like to do this. So it's an incredibly conservative organization. And I am not Japanese, but I know how to build stories and get people out there. So I work behind the scenes to try to get people out there. And a lot of other people were involved in it as well. But we did manage to get that passed, which was amazing. And then that inspired the Organization of Chinese Americans. They said, we want to do the same thing. And I was like, that's awesome, except you don't have a national meeting. And so it's going to be totally different. Also, the issues that you've got are different. So I think that you should, you know, like knowing your group, knowing the issues, knowing what I know about the Chinese community and the form of homophobia that was the most strong was actually across immigration. So there was a lot of people who were native to not the United States who were saying, if we had never sent you here, you never would have been gay. And so there was a lot of stuff, especially at the time, that was about, you know, I can't talk to them looking the way that I do, not coming from that culture, and speaking English, and convince anybody of anything. So we need a video. You know, we need a video, we need to be in Mandarin and Cantonese and English, and we need to tell personal stories from the first person point of view. This is what we need. And he said, that's awesome, when are you going to be done? And I was like, I don't make videos. And they said, well, you make beer. It's the same thing. And I was like, really not. But they said, oh, we believe that you can do it. So I actually did find a co-director who was from Hong Kong, who's
if I had to pick one thing that would, you know, it would be this one thing that I think is kind of, that kind of, where it's, you know, sort of 10 levels into it, all kinds of other stuff, would be working anything that moves. And I work in anything that moves from, I guess, I got to the day, I guess, January of 99, and I still have the agenda from the first meeting I attended in April, in April of 1999, after I met with Member Howard Valentine. She came out for a Starbucks, and she came out to meet me about the meeting the next month at Queer, what we will call it, Queer Central, on that on Mission and 10th Street. I wrote I had the opportunity to write a story, and it was the first, like, longest, but like, expository writing I had done in a long time, called We Got Family, that I wrote, I guess it was in the summer of 1999 issue of AFL News. And it was basically, to keep it short, was about, I grew up, just to give you some background, I grew up in cultural nationalism, black nationalism, attended after century school in Chicago in the 70s, which I call that kind of Kwanzaa Central. And we kind of joke, the kids who grew up in it, we kind of joke about Kwanzaa, it's like where you go to see, like, if there are any other kids who look like you, kind of thing. That's another story. But it took a while to laugh about that. But I wrote this piece about, I was in a really bad space over the last 5 years with my natal family. My parents in particular, my sister actually came out as is still queer, still lesbian, came out when I was about 15 years old. So she took like a sort of lot of sort of the benign kind of experience. I didn't experience, like a lot of people I had experienced. My family was sort of escape working class, middle class, so I didn't experience the sort of religious damnation, hellfire, churchy homophobia that a lot of people experience in the community. I didn't experience any of that. It was really just kind of sideways and couched in, you know, black powerism, kind of that way, in that kind of way. And I think there was this, but there was also this other experience of like, even as a queer person, there was still like a black monosexually gay ghetto in African American community that I could have existed in tenuously, whereas like being bisexual, I was free in this other kind of way. And this is before you even get to non-monogamy or kink or anything else. There was this sort of, I mean, a lot of communities have this about these politics of normativity, you know, and the way that's enforced by people who experience racism, who experience homophobia, and so that goes to the idea of like, it started a conversation for me about intersectionality before I actually even had that word, because of a lot of experiences that I had that I was trying to talk about, because it was the story focused on 1995 and the Million Man March, and how my father went to the Million Man March, and there was all this conflict we had on it, and I was like, go ahead, I understand what this means for you growing up in a black color cold camp in West Virginia, and all that kind of stuff, and growing up in Jim Crow. I'm like, you do that and go. But I talked to him the day he came back, and he was in tears, you know, about his experience of that. He was just like, hey, I'm sitting in the crowd with a million brothers, and there was a light fight, you know, thing like that, that kind of thing. I said, okay, so it started about us having a complicated conversation about who he thought he was, who he understood himself to be, and who he understood to be. He is his oldest son, and all the stuff that was wrapped up, you know, in that. And that is not to say that there was that I had a perfect or a conscious experience in bisexual community. A bisexual community that was not intersexually oriented in a lot of ways, especially at that time. And there were a lot of conversations that came up about that, but it's not just about community, but about my own privileged experience at that moment. Privilege and lack. Like, for example, I was marginally housed when I moved to San Francisco, had been homeless previous to joining staff and anything that moved. But there was also stuff that I talked about things I continued to get to do, starting with like meeting Judge and Rainbow Flavor, the conversation we had. That was essentially kind of a higher gun, Rainbow Flavor. It was already a thing. But he talked about how there's a way that he was experiencing biphobia in gay community and the way they were related to this particular hip hop project, and the way that people were experiencing it, because he was a contextually white dude, and who was leading the project, and how that extended into conversation we had in Deep Dip Collective, in the sense of how two of the founding members of Deep Dip Collective were actually out of bisexual, me and Philip Akiva Goff, who you might know was Nerdy Show Tonight, he's like on the Daily Show. Who's on the Daily Show and talking about the race bomb and stuff, you gotta be here to fall and rest and that stuff. But very much of the conversation that I had when DTC started, when the whole homo hop thing started to get legs, and how we were able to have these conversations, because the way the internet was happening in 99, 2000, that we were able to get this attention, that there was a way that I was able to talk about that way that I did, the things that I did, because college educated, like post-grad, or a way that people would listen to me, because masculine, and cis dude, and even the bisexual dude passed for a lot of people straight, or people projecting straightness, you know, onto me, or just even in Deep Dip Collective, that like two or three guys started a group of Ivy educated. So we were normative and normalized, and say, even the bisexual guy, I would say the safe guy, because people could put the you could sprinkle me with that particular thing. And at the same time there was a whole authentication that was happening, where there were stories, and I read a story once that said I grew up in the hard scrabble for reading great projects of Chicago. And I'm like, I didn't know nobody who was from the projects until I was in high school, I lived in a house with like hot water and orange juice, refrigerator shit. You know, so just even the conversations around privilege, the way that was navigated, and also too, that there was a way that I got to have the conversation, because you talk about us, that was ostensibly a monosexually gay community, like you talk about people like Marlon Riggs and Essex Temp Hill and the gay literary movement of the late 80s and the mid 1990s, yeah, was something I kind of stood on the shoulders of. But there was the community, the arts community I had here, was at least publicly was monosexually, I say was monosexually gay. That there was a way that these conversations ended up happening. It was like, well, you look a freaky weirdo dude over here. Well, what do you know about the bisexual? So that like, so there was a personal experience of like this sort of sideways biphobia, but it also served to make to put me in relief in a way that allowed me to have these other conversations and to be this public thing for a lot of people, who was like, so I became the bisexual one, you know, the bisexual one, and in this sort of weird way represented possibility for people like this. And that became another thing, even like you talk about most of my experience, aside from like HIV work and health advocacy, had been trying to have some of these conversation within the music community I was in. It's like, you know, really this is, y'all want to be famous, that's cool, but this is about more for me than having a record deal. There's a lot of conversations that we get to have through music and through popular music that we don't get to have in an academic space, and that we wouldn't have necessarily even in a space like this. So I think it became in a lot of ways. To give an example of that, is anybody here familiar with Pick Up the Mic, the documentary Pick Up the Mic? Mm-hmm. If you've seen this, it's a documentary that followed the homo hop scene, and it came out in 2006, prepared for the Toronto Film Festival, and went to about 50,000. You probably watched it online somewhere. But one of the things that happened I'll end with this to give you an idea of what was going on. So they flew about 15 of us up to Toronto in September 2005. And so we're going to do press and going to screens, and of course all of us ended up sitting in a hotel room. And when you have people sitting, eat pizza, drink in a hotel room, what happens when you sit in people in a hotel room at a conference? You start doing truth and dare. So question comes up, Juba. Okay, so like you come up, questions come, and everybody's going around. Have you had sex with anybody who was involved with the production or anything that's going up here? I'm like, oh, like, yeah, sure. And it's like, this person, that person, it was like, and there were a couple women, and I said, and David, and they like, huh? right, I mean, so Carol's laughing, right? Carol's laughing. Because there's a whole story about Blade and Wesley Snipes and Chris Christopherson and the whole gay daddy-like thing, and how, like, I'm like, wow, who knew 3 years later that I would be Blade and I would have a white gay daddy? that's a whole nother story. But the thing about that was, I talked to Tori Fitch, who was actually in Rainbow Flavor later, and I was like, we were talking about that later, like about a year later, what that was about. And he said there was another time he was sitting in a room and with everybody in the room. This is after I've done Peace Out, coordinated all this stuff, DDC for a couple of years. These guys are sitting in the room and everybody's like, he's straight. I know he's straight. My wife, he's straight. He's straight. He's straight. He's straight. And it was really this thing about, even among a bunch of faggots, a bunch of faggots and dykes, a bunch of queer motherfuckers, your internalized homophobia is such that you need to make, and biphobia is such that you need to have a straight, masculine, cis male avatar of this shit that you're doing, and that you need to have a straight body, a heteronormative body in the middle of it. And I was just like, it didn't matter, all this advocacy, all this stuff that I had an opportunity to participate in, that they were still trying to do this at the same time. God damn. You know, and so it made me really kind of conscious, like going forward. And that was even internal stuff, even in Dedicolect, believe it or not, which was kind of like, you know, behind the music without any money. But it wasn't, I didn't fuck anybody in DDC, so welcome to Fleetwood Mac kind of thing. but just to go to show you, even when we have the stuff that, like, everybody has been saying here, even in the middle of the stuff that works, there's still this stuff to work on in this, like, internalized, you know, way that kind of plays out. So that story, there's still stuff that's happening, you know, around that. But that was the story that kind of started the threads of, like, okay, we at that bi plus, or like bi is the boundary that's being crossed, and it's all these other kind of things. And not just even necessarily about sexuality, but when I'm talking about bisexual, I'm talking about being, you know, like being faggot identified, being black, being a crip, being from Chicago, as opposed to being from Baltimore, being black in San Francisco. There's all of these sort of spectrum of things that is in conversations that I'm talking about, where, like, culturally, where people are socialized to have one note, you know, about everything, and how it's easy to be done, you know, about everything. And so bisexuality was a problem in terms of biphobia, specific around sexuality, but also a problem about forcing all of these other conversations at the same time. Well, and not even forcing them, but the potentiality.
Moved us into what was going to be my next session, which is, of course, about intersectionality. And I know that everyone at the table, being bi is not the only part of who they are. And I'm actually going to go to Mara first. And my question is really about how being bi intersects with at least one other part of who you are.
I answered this question early because I was doing like the GSA kind of interview thing, and I said that, like, I'm like a lot of things in terms of interests and hobbies, and just, like, you know, kind of like, yeah, I but if I were to name just like simple characteristics about myself, being Latina, being young, being bisexual, those, I know this is kind of heavy, but those are like very, very popular porn categories, right? So those are very big things that fetishize when they see what they want to see. I found that, I feel like my gender, race, and sexuality always play in, because there are always these stereotypes of, like, Latinas, and how, like, those females are spicy, or, like, they're foreign. And the fact that I believe myself to be conventionally attractive, I'm, like, white passing, I'm on light skin, so I have those events, like, I've not been just the little privileges, and now I'm Latina and I'm bisexual, so, like, it's mostly up for grabs, but I'm pretty invisible on some areas. But I think I'm not so desirable, but I am kind of something that people look for. It's also been kind of, like, difficult, because I feel like when being queer is discussed in, like, lot of people, which is great, they feel comfortable to say what they are and, like, you know, that's who they are. And it's just coming, it's gradually becoming more accepted, but there are things that kind of, like, go along with it. I think also, like, I kind of touched on earlier, is that I do have a boyfriend, and it's just, like, when people kind of find out, they're, like, looking, like, you're, you know, what's going on, it's, like, it's not like that. He's very respectful of my identities, never asked them any of these questions, and it's just people, like, they look at him differently in the sense of, like, that must be a lot to handle, or, like, oh, wow, that's, like, kind of cool. And it's not something that I should have to carry on with him, it's, like, that doesn't have to play into it. And it's just, like, hard to kind of navigate through stuff like that. But, like, you do it, and, like, if, when I find myself discussing, like, social justice things, which kind of activism, I like to bring in those other identities as well. So if you're talking about queer issues, I want to see what they're discussing about black and brown issues and, like, other issues. And yeah, I mean, not embodied, like, undocumented people, disabled people, and alternatively, like, we're discussing, you know, Latino issues, are you being, are you, like, incorporating, like, non-binary Latinos, or, like, the kind of discussion of people being comfortable with Latinx and not Latino or Latina. So it's just, it's kind of, like, hard to always kind of incorporate that, because who else is going to do it besides you? Because nobody else, I mean, people care in the sense where it's, like, they're directly impacted, you know, we always feel like, oh, you're black, or you should feel it, and then it's, like, I always kind of find that, like, I'm my own friend a lot of different ways, like, I would act, I'm advocating for myself, and then it's just, well, like I said, who else is going to do it? But also, it's something that I don't need to do, but I find myself doing. So it's a bit tiresome sometimes. I feel like, oh, I didn't even consider that. And so I think that's good. Now we can have a kind of great discussion about, like, other mental health issues.
Someone else?
From the door.
that is added on. The one piece that kind of also sits across those, people like to talk about it, even though it's a really strong factor. People knew we were talking about the music and the hip-hop and all this thing like that. And kids, they were talking about certain different things. Okay, yes, that's such a person that lives in that area. But that's a particular plan. Depending on what you do for money, legal or illegal, there's a particular type of class that you are associated in. There may be freedom to express in that or not. Folks who are more economically in a different particular class, or professional, there's a little bit more freedom for them. Blue collar or working class or homeless, there's a little less freedom to express that. So, in the intersection, I come from working class, but I'm a professional. So it's in an area where they weren't used to seeing that, hearing that. So it's a little different. And as an African American man, you know, we get, oh, you're here. Okay, so on. So then, oh, you're not gay. No. I love that. Even in the silo of a particular community, when we were talking to you, I thought about Ngada, and I had conversations with Ngada about being bisexual and being part of it. For those who don't know, Ngada is lesbian, gay, African American. Why would I have to argue with you to be part of it? I'm bisexual if you're gay, but. So, it's weird at times, the policies. But yeah, when we look at how we operate in our community, class piece kind of overrides some things in the sense that if you are particularly class, you're a certain area, then you're visible or invisible.
It isn't exactly live action for me right now, but certainly as part of my overarching understanding of myself and my history, and that's a sex worker. And I feel like part of, I'm only 99% retired because in this economy, you know, who knows, really. But one of the things that's interesting to me about the sex industry, I mean, I think we learned from the relatively recent white paper, what do you call it, but that research thing that Binet USA participated in. And some of you may not know about this. This was, what, 3 years ago maybe? And it talked about different kinds of discrimination and health and wellness outcomes for bi-identified people. And it really represented by women as being the most likely to be sexually harassed or aggressed upon in pretty much anybody. And I went, oh, that's kind of interesting. And I think it has to do with, it was one of the things that my old school dykes used to bitch about, as a matter of fact, is there's a sexualization that goes on for bi women in particular.
Yeah,
right? Yeah. Right? And, perhaps in some part of me decided that if I couldn't beat it, I would join it. But in reality, the story I tell myself is that being a sexologist American, that just seemed like a good way to get a whole lot more information about sex, kind of on the hook, and also being immigrant at the same time. So doing sex work brought me into this world where people's sexual identities and desires were fluid, often commodified, always. There were people who were acting in bisexual ways for money. There were people who found that sex work gave them a space to have more sort of sexual freedom and fluidity, then it was easier for them to figure out I'm not the only bi woman I knew in sex work who was like, wow, it's a lot easier to walk up to one of my colleagues and say, hey, you want to do a double? And like, do I think she's awesome and am I hot for her? That's an extra plus. And I think we see it sometimes in clients too. There's gender fluidity in the client space sometimes. There's, I remember by all accounts, cis hetero guy who, when he got comfortable enough with me, was like, what if we play with a strap on? Cool. And then, do you know any guys? Oh, I see where you're going with this, right? So that the space of sex work made a place where I and some other people that I knew could be bi and sexually exploratory and expressive in ways that, because we had this this umbrella that we acknowledged that we were working within this context, the over-sexualization had a reason for being. That didn't always mean for everyone, I think, that it was a good thing overall, and it certainly didn't always mean that it was a bad thing overall. It was complicated. Mm-hmm. And I really like you said something about the mind wanting to simplify, because every time I've gotten in front of an audience and talked about sex work, I've really wanted to say, we've got to complexify it to understand it, not simplify it. Mm-hmm. There's more diversity, class, culture, race, et cetera, within sex work than we usually talk about differentiate. There's more diversity of sexual orientation and sexual behavior, whether it matches the orientation or whether it doesn't. It's a silo and a corral, but it's a playpen and a space of exploration for people sometimes as well. Mm-hmm. And it certainly was all out of them.
Yeah, it's just Kawada made me think about some stuff, and Carol did too at the same time. Just to give some like a little background, Carol produced the first porn I had to do, G Mark the Spot, in 2003. And I remember when that first happened, I'm like just out for my parents about everything. And my mom was like, I want to see it. and my wife was like, who I've been doing, this is like now 16, and she's like, I think you just like let her forget about that and walk that back. I said, yeah, I think that's what I want to do too. But both of my parents did, when I toured the Sex Workers Art Show in 2006, both of them showed up, and they had their, it's like if you watch Blackish, that's kind of my parents. They both live with my brother. Like, and my dad still has a girlfriend, so that's to give you some idea about what kind of parents that I have. But Kawada made me think about this, and that, like, my dad is one of, we're mostly working class family, like coal miners and on one side, but they're like nurses and mail carriers and that kind of thing, like very great migration like type family. But my dad was one of the first people in my family to get a master's degree. He taught elementary school, middle school for about 28 years. My brother's a school teacher. And I did it like an undergrad. I was an elementary and high school teacher in Chicago in the early and mid-90s. But after I moved, the what was interesting was about like the class stuff and the intersecting stuff, about the difference between what that meant to be a great migration person and move from West Virginia to Chicago versus being black and moving from Chicago to the San Francisco, Oakland, regardless of the history of Oakland and San Francisco we've been sitting here talking about. It's like another planet in these ways. So I did a master's degree at New College of California in poetics, and with a minor in activist performance. And so my dad had this, for years, had this affectionate nickname for me, WM, which was like short for white man. And what it really was about is, because it's clearly not about me being white or even being white passing. It's not about that. But it's about his relationship, but it's about the class relationship to privilege and the way that you have a deconstructionist or an intersectional conversation, which for him stopped at race and his experience as a black, as a remember him saying one day, I finished the master's degree in 2006, and I've been talking to him, and him saying, so let me get this straight. You got a degree in being gay? You can hear him, right? You hear him.
Which is sort of, what do you think is left?
acceptance of the complexities of such oppression in quashing it and hiding it, and it calls for us to really be visible and friendly. Even though we're in the 21st century, 2018, there's still opportunities for us to be present. Yes, but I am not gay, I'm not lesbian, I'm not trans, and this is who I am, this is my expression, and it's valid.
Not only that, but I think one of
And he goes, yeah, he's bisexual. And I'm like, what's that? And he's like, it means he likes boys and girls. And I'm like, oh, I'm a vampire. But it was like, part of what was important, that's one of the little facets in the sense that like, I was like, I wasn't tyrannized about my desire for attraction to women, but I knew there was something else going on, and I just didn't have a word for it, but didn't come out until 10 years later. 4 years after that, I'm in college, and tongues untied. They didn't say bisexual and tongues untied. They were all monosexually, as far as I knew, monosexually gay men, but having seen, you know, guys who I eventually met and became friends and mentored me, and seeing men who were pushing against that, you know, against this, you know, idea of that there was this one way to be, was this really kind of important thing. And even like a little later than that, by the time I actually came out, I had a friend, a good friend of mine, Marguerite Harrell, who's in Chicago, who still lives in Chicago now, who dated Corey Glover, the lead singer from Living Color, right? And, you know, I got to meet Corey on stuff, and the friend was a DJ in my hip-hop group, and he was like, Corey, what you doing? Like, whatever, like, because they were just all a bunch of straight boys to me. And then they're on Jay Leno doing Bye. And I'm sitting 2 years later, and I'm like, they're talking to me. They're talking to me. He's speaking to me. Of course, he wasn't speaking to me, you know, directly, but it was like, this moment when there wasn't the internet, there was a black man talking about everybody loves you when, you know, everybody loves you when you buy on national television. And I'm watching this in my living room. And I was losing, I had just come out. And I was losing my mind. And I didn't see ATL until another year, you know, after that. And so for me, it's just like those kind of pieces, those kind of moments, those kind of little pieces of daring to be, whichever kind of piece of you or whoever that is all of those kind of things become important, because those were rafts, those were stepping stones, those were lifelines, you know, for me, and notions of possibility. Mm-hmm. So I say with that, like, whatever that germ is for you, whatever that little sprinkle of glitter is for you, or that you have that you might take for granted, you know, for somebody, that is something that's going to mean something. So like saying that to bask and to revel in your, like, fabulariness, to use another ATM, you know, ATM term. That this is kind of what this is about for me. 20 years from now, nobody would care if there were 6 or 60 people here. They would care that this happened. Mm-hmm. And this